Hello, ladies and gentlemen, from autumnal, almost wintry Hamburg, and welcome to today's live broadcast on how to protect yourselves with proper pipetting. Our webinar will be presented to you by my lovely colleagues, Dr. Nadine Mays and Dr. Katja Besler. Both are application specialists focusing on cell handling and liquid handling here for Eppendorf. I will give you a short introduction about both of them in a minute. My name is Christian Haberland, Marketing Manager for Instruments and Systems here at Eppendorf, and I will be your moderator for today's event. And at the end of the webinar, I would like to give you a quick overview about solutions that might be helpful for you to improve your daily cell culture work. Before we begin, I would like to encourage you all to get the most out of this webinar by submitting as many questions as you want at any time you want during the presentation. Simply type them into the Ask a Question box on the left and click Send. We will answer as many questions as we have time for at the end of the webinar. If you have any trouble to see or hear the presentation, click on the Support tab at the top right or report your problem by clicking on the Ask a Question box on the left. Continuing educational credits can be obtained by clicking simply on the tab at the top right and following the procedure. If you would like to stay updated on all upcoming cell culture webinars by Eppendorf, simply click on the Inside Cell Culture tab at the top. Just type in your name and your email address to receive a monthly newsletter dedicated to cell culture experts with helpful videos, posters, tips and tricks, and more. And you can also find an example on the newsletter page on the registration page. Now, let me shortly introduce the presenters of your webinar today. Dr. Nadine Mays and Katja Besler both hold a PhD in biology with a focus on and many years of experience in cell culture. Both are amongst our most experienced application specialists focusing on cell and liquid handling here at Eppendorf. And you can find a complete biography of both speakers by clicking on the biography tab at the top. We are happy that Nadine and Katja are going to share their knowledge with us today. So enough of the talking from my side, let's get started. Nadine and Katja, the stage is yours.
Thank you very much for the kind introduction, Christian. Structuring this webinar, four main topics will be covered. First, we will give an introduction into the pipetting fundamentals. Then we will talk about contamination prevention before we get into the details of pipetting techniques in cell culture. In the end, you will get information on how to get from cell seeding to cell banking in a short as well as a short summary. Everybody working in a lab is pipetting every single day. And as most things we do every day, we do not much think about it anymore. But when it comes to this critical step in an experiment, everything can be changed and minimal differences in pipetting can decide on the results being precise and satisfying or disappointing. Furthermore, accurate pipetting technique is necessary when publishing data, so that everyone can follow proper pipetting rules and can redo the experiment and verify your results. Actually, as we are pipetting so much, it should be one of our major concerns, as it is having one of the highest impacts of all techniques on our experiments. On the start of each experiment stands the choice of the right or correct pipetting tool. Let us have a look on the different devices one can use. When talking about pipetting and choosing the right tool, it is important to know that there are two major systems: the air cushion system and the positive displacement system. The system we all know the best and which we all have in mind when it comes to pipetting are the air cushion pipettes. Here the piston is part of the pipette and moving up and down the pipette cone, so that there is no contact between the liquid which is in the pipette tip and the piston. There's an air cushion in between. While in the positive displacement system, on the other hand, there is a direct contact of the liquid and the piston, because here the piston is integrated in the tip and not in the pipette. Here we do not have an air cushion when moving the liquid. And these devices working with this system are known usually as dispenser or stepper. The different pipette forms vary in their handling, precision and throughput. Usually, one can choose between manual, electronic, or even automatic systems. In manual pipettes or dispensers, the technique and the speed are under user control. While in electronic pipettes, the technique is under user control, but the speed is under device control. Electronic systems are usually more ergonomic and flexible regarding different programs, and one can work much faster. For automated systems, both technique and speed are under device control. Here, the risk of pipetting mistakes is minimized, which is especially a problem when it comes to a very high throughput. Each pipetting tool is ideal for one application. For example, a pipette helper with serological pipettes should be used for larger volumes, like the transfer of liquids from cell culture flasks, medium bottles, or conical tubes, for example, as in the exchange of culture medium. Single and multi-channel pipettes are ideal for applications where the precision is more important. When it comes to small volumes, less than 1 milliliter, the requested precisions and accuracy are much higher. These small volumes are mainly used in, for example, cell seeding and addition of compounds and assay reagents, as well as when working with cryovials or microtubes. When using multi-well plates, a dispenser or multi-channel pipette makes sense to add the medium and compounds fast and precise. Dispensers can be used from 1 microliter up to 50 milliliter by using the same device and just exchanging the tip size. So what we see here is that each device has its optimal tip. They build a system. And additionally, it is important and it's highly recommended to use the tips from the manufacturer by the same company as the pipetting tool, since there's only then a perfectly system can be guaranteed. One special challenge in cell culture is pipetting of different types of liquids, like, for example, cell culture medium that builds up a lot of foam due to the high protein content. Viscous liquids like DMSO are not only used as cryoprotectants, but also in a lot of other applications, as, for example, as solvents for drugs or inhibitors. Due to its viscosity, a large amount of liquid can remain in the tip when pipetting DMSO, which leads to false concentrations in the end. Also, ethanol, for example, is quite often used in cell culture labs, either as a disinfectant or solvent or for any lyophilized components. But its high vapor pressure actually makes it difficult to pipette correct volumes, since ethanol tends to drip out of the pipette tip after aspirating. To deal with these liquids, we will take a look on the different pipetting mechanisms. But first, I have a question for you to answer, which is, which pipetting instrument do you use for your cell culture? You can select any that apply. Do you use manual or electronic dispensers, which means the positive displacement? Do you use manual and or electronic air cushion pipettes, or do you use electronic pipette controller and serological pipettes? We will give you a short minute to answer. I can reread the question. So which pipetting instrument do you use for your cell culture? You can select any that applies. Do you use manual or electronic dispensers, manual or electronic air cushion pipettes, or electronic pipette controller and serological pipettes? Okay, let's just wait another second. Okay, so you answered about 25, less than 25% answered that they use a manual and or electronic dispenser. About a bit more than 50% answered that they use electronic or manual air cushion pipettes. And about 66% answered that they use an electronic pipette controller and as well as serological pipettes. As we already discussed, the classic pipettes we know are the air cushion pipettes. And as I already said, the name derives from the air inside the pipette that is between the liquid and the instrument's piston. As you can see, the liquid has direct contact with the air inside the pipette, and therefore the formation of aerosols can lead to contamination inside of the pipette. And we will talk about aerosol formation in a few minutes. This system is widely distributed and actually only suitable for correct pipetting of aqueous solutions. Problematic liquids like with a higher density like DMSO or with a higher vapor pressure like ethanol cannot be pipetted accurate without a special technique or adjustment of the pipette, which is time-consuming. Less sensible are positive displacement pipettes. Here the liquid is soaked into a tip with an integrated piston, as we discussed already before. As there is the direct contact between the liquid and the piston and no air cushion, the risk of contaminating the pipette from the inside is eliminated. This system additionally allows the transfer of most liquids accurately, no matter if they have a high density or high vapor pressure or are just aqueous. So when it comes to problematic liquids, dispensers are more precise and more accurate than air cushion pipettes. The tip of the dispenser is filled once and then the liquid can be dispensed in multiple steps. This is especially suitable for cell culture when working with plates. But with an electronic device, it is also possible to perform pipetting, meaning dispensing the aspirated liquid in just one step. So for now, I hand over to Nadine for the second part of this webinar.
Thank you, Katja. In this next chapter, I would like to talk about some general aspects of reducing the risk of contaminating your cells. But before I start, here comes our next poll question. And we ask you to participate by clicking. So here's a question. Have you ever had any problems with contamination in your cell culture lab? So the possible answers are never, rarely, sometimes, or on a regular basis. So we are waiting a few seconds until your answers are coming in. I can see that the first answers are coming in. We will wait a few seconds more. I can just reread the question. So we would like to know if you ever have had any problems with contamination in your cell culture lab. So the possible answers are never, rarely, sometimes, or on a regular basis. Okay, I think we can have a look at the results now. So thank you for participating. We can see when looking at the results that 7% of you never see contamination of their cells, whereas more than 60 and nearly 30% of you are facing contamination rarely or even or sometimes in the cell culture lab. So let's have a look at the presentation and the different types of contamination. So contamination is maybe the biggest challenge when working in a cell culture lab. In general, we find two major types of contaminants, the microbial ones and the eukaryotic. The microbial contaminations are fungi and yeast, bacteria, and especially mycoplasma. The other ones, the eukaryotic, are not necessarily so well known and are cross-contamination of other eukaryotic cells in cell lines. This phenomenon was first described in 1967, and to date it is estimated that up to 20% of cell lines used in labs worldwide are either cross-contaminated or even misidentified. No matter what type of contamination we are talking about, I think we can all agree on the consequences. Loss of time, since you have to repeat experiments, increase in cost, because time is money and you need more material. Loss of reproducibility, you might have completely different responses when you work with contaminated and non-contaminated cells. And the last point might be the most horrific one, the loss of significance. If you want to find out a new therapeutic treatment for breast cancer, but you work with melanoma cells without knowing it, the results of your work are doubtful. So taken together, avoiding contamination is much easier than dealing with it. There are so many different possibilities of getting contamination, so prevention is almost a logical step. Maintaining a sterile environment has first priority in a cell culture lab, but instead of sterile, maybe I should better call it germ-reduced environment, because this is the actual truth. For example, the inside of an incubator is never sterile. Every time the door is opened, germs can enter the incubator, plus the atmosphere inside the incubator is disturbed. Therefore, door openings should be reduced in duration and frequency as much as possible. Preventive hygiene plays a big role in preventing contamination. That means that regular cleaning of lab equipment like incubators, water baths, biosafety cabinets is a must. Also, personal protective equipment is very important. You should have a dedicated lab coat that you only wear inside the cell culture lab. Every other type of personal protective equipment, like, for example, lab shoes, further reduce the risk of contamination. Your workspace in the laminar flow hood is the place of action and the place where most mistakes can happen. I will come back to this point in more detail later on. All preventive hygiene and personal protective equipment and organization is useless when you do not take care of your aseptic technique while handling cells, reagents, and last but not least, pipettes. The person who's working in the cell culture lab is maybe the biggest source of contamination. Your hands are the major source of germ transfer when handling the cells. It might be trivial to specifically mention, but when entering the cell culture lab, the first thing to do should be washing the hands. Disinfecting your hands before putting on gloves further reduces the contamination risk. Another advice is to use hand cream regularly because healthy skin has fewer germs than dry skin. When you put on gloves, disinfect them sufficiently. That means let them dry before you start working. And disinfect them not only once but repeatedly. For example, when you adjust your glasses, never do it without subsequent hand disinfection. You can also tuck the sleeves of your lab coat in the glove. I already mentioned the importance of having a lab coat that is reserved for the cell culture lab. Same applies, of course, for any other type of equipment. Especially pipettes and tip boxes are easy to carry from one lab to the other, which should be strictly forbidden. A good tip is to simply put a sticker on each pipette and label it with cell culture. So everybody knows that this pipette should be kept inside the cell culture lab. Disinfect the pipettes each time before you place them in the hood. Do it by wiping with a disinfectant to allow complete wetting of the surface. If you choose a new pipette for cell culture, consider one that is easy to clean with a smooth surface that does not have any or many rough edges and grooves. You can also disassemble the pipettes to clean them from the inside if necessary. Autoclavable pipettes give extra safety. When you are pipetting, try to avoid moving your hands or arms over open vessels. The T-flask is the most widely used vessel for routine maintenance of cell cultures. Its secure screw cap offers best protection of valuable cells. However, compared to dishes and plates, the T-flask provides only limited access to the cells due to its narrow neck, which makes handling with pipettes and cell scrapers inconvenient. In the past, some modifications were made to cell culture T-flasks to improve the access to the cells. The initial straight neck of the flask made way for the invention of a canted neck that provides a better access, especially when using serological pipettes. Meanwhile, some manufacturers offer a so-called canted neck where an additional ramp is supposed to eliminate dead corners, for example, inaccessible parts of the growth area. The Eppendorf cell culture flask goes one step further. Its unique convex access neck provides the user with optimal room for all liquid handling steps and protects the cell monolayer against unintended scratching with a pipette. The screw caps of cell culture flasks usually contain a thin membrane filter with vertically aligned pores of 0.2 micrometer size. In contrast, the Eppendorf T flasks are equipped with caps containing a depth filter, which is thicker and has a labyrinthine structure with various pore sizes and shapes. While gas exchange through the filter is not impacted, the Eppendorf filter cap is able to hold back mycoplasma and thus prevents spreading an infection throughout the lab. In contrast to the standard membrane filters with defined pore size used by other suppliers of T-flasks, the Eppendorf filter caps cannot be penetrated by mycoplasma. The labyrinth-like structure of the thick filter pad with pores of various sizes and shapes forms a reliable barrier for mycoplasma. At the beginning of this chapter, I mentioned the importance of having an organized working place in the biosafety cabinet. As this is the area where you open the dishes, plates, or flasks with the cells, there are some things to be kept in mind to avoid contamination. You should always work in the middle third of the working space, not too much in the front or not too much in the back, because there you disturb the laminar airflow in the cabinet. Another advice is not to block the air grills in the front, the back, or the sides with research notes, discarded plastic wrappers, pipette devices, and so on. Disinfect the working area in the hood completely, let it dry before every use. Disinfect every piece of equipment that you bring in. Every item that is in there disturbs the laminar airflow that keeps germs outside. So don't overcrowd your workspace with items that you do not need for the particular working step. Any droplets or spills need to be cleaned immediately. When working at the hood, it is a good advice to have one clean side with culture media, pipettes, and new consumables, and the other side is reserved for liquid waste, use tips, and so on. And with this, I would like to hand over to Katja again, who will proceed with the next chapter, pipetting techniques in cell culture.
Thank you very much, Nadine. Now let us have a look on what is important when pipetting in cell culture experiments. So these are the important things. The first thing is protection. So on the following slides, when we use the term protection to describe, we mean by it, of course, that all steps have to be performed under sterile conditions. But some methods are safer than others. For example, if you think about the distance to the cells or your reagent to your potentially non-sterile hand, a serological pipette, for example, has like a 30-centimeter distance to your hands. A dispenser, for example, has approximately 10-centimeter distance, and a normal pipette with a tip just approximately 4 centimeters. So a serological pipette is usually safer than the others, even when special precautions are taken. Another important factor in cell culture is precision. This term we use here in all slides, and we actually refer to the terms precision and accuracy with this word. The third important factor is time as well as cost. Pipetting of a 96-well plate with a single-channel or multi-channel pipette is a good comparison of speed and therefore also for the cost per sample. One important thing to talk about when it comes to protection are aerosols. What are aerosols? An aerosol is a colloid of fine solid particles or liquid droplets in air. Aerosols are formed always when a liquid is transferred. Especially when using warm liquids like, for example, cell culture medium at 37 degrees in room temperature conditions. A very slight evaporation leads to very small aerosol drops that can contaminate the inside of the pipette and with this lead to cross-contamination of samples. As you see in the illustrated picture, the pipette tip has an effective barrier against aerosol formation is a filter tip. A filter tip can stop small aerosols and contaminants such as bacteria or viruses to get into the pipette. However, using a dispenser with a fresh tip every time, 100% aerosol contamination for 100% aerosol contamination can be inhibited, as there is simply no air to form an aerosol with. However, when using filter tips, we recommend you to use a two-layered filter tip. Its filter layers, the first filter layer retains drops and splashes and larger particles like bacteria. The second layer retains smaller aerosols, like, for example, biomolecules like DNA or RNA, as well as virus particles that could contaminate the pipette cone and cross-contaminate your sample. There are also some other tricks on how you can avoid aerosol formation in general, as aerosols are not only formed during pipetting. Mix your samples by gentle rolling rather than vigorous shaking. Pipette directly into the liquid or onto the surface in order to avoid bubbling and splashing. Place the containers very close to each other when transferring the liquids in between them to avoid drops that fall and splash. And importantly, slowly remove tube caps or stoppers. The needed precision and accuracy always depends on your application. You know the best when it's necessary to be the most precise and when it's not so important. One widely used tool is an electronic pipette helper, but keep in mind that the liquid volume is mainly defined by the person using the electronic pipette helper. The meniscus in the serological pipette is seen by the person pipetting and stopped when the volume on the graduation is reached. This is a very personal system and least precise, but a fast option when precision is not so important. A more precise option are manual pipettes. These are suitable for all aqueous solutions, but still here the technique is under user control and the speed as well. With electronic pipettes, the speed is device controlled and only the technique is the precision limiting factor. However, when handling liquids with other properties than water, precision and accuracy might not be very high. The highest precision with all kinds of liquids is achieved using a dispenser. The device dispenses the same amount of liquid on each stroke, either manually or electronic controlled. But let us have a closer look on the tools. So, as I said, for larger volumes where precision is not so important, an electronic pipette helper is sufficient, for example, when exchanging culture medium. Also, when using flasks, it might be of advantage to use serological pipettes and a pipette helper. The second option you have using pipettes are pipettes with elongated tips, for example, for volumes up to 10 milliliter, or a dispenser with elongated tips or longer tips to avoid contacting the inside of a tube or flask. The second option is the more precise one. However, in the end, you have to decide whether the protection of your sample via the larger distance by the serological pipettes or a more precise pipetting result by using pipettes or dispenser is essential for your application. Here's an example on what I mean by protection. In this picture, you see a pipette cone reaching into the tube. The contamination risk is extremely high. Depending on the vessel type you are using in your application, the right pipette tool use is as important as the whole experimental setup. If you are using smaller tubes, up to 5 milliliter, a manual pipette or dispenser should be used. For example, the 5 milliliter tube is safer to work with a normal air cushion pipette instead of using a 15 milliliter tube or flask. If you are using a 15 milliliter or 50 milliliter tube, a dispenser and the according tip is a safe option as well. You do not get into the cone without contact of the device. If you still want to use an air cushion pipette, I highly recommend you to use elongated tips. But you can also rethink your choice of vessel type. Since a few weeks, the 25 milliliter tubes are available on the market. These tubes are not as high as the 15 or 50 milliliter conical tubes, and using these with air cushion pipettes helps a lot to minimize the contamination risk. For flasks and bottles, I recommend you to use a pipette controller and serological pipettes, as here often precision is not as important. Be better safe than sorry. If precision is important, also here use air cushion pipettes with elongated tips or a dispenser with longer tips. When pipetting large volumes, do not do it upright over the open flask, as contaminants may fall into the open flask. Use a 45-degree angle when pipetting out or into the vessels with a pipette controller and serological pipettes. When pipetting smaller volumes, accuracy and precision are usually more important for your assay or addition of components. Therefore, a manual or electronic pipette or dispenser are most suitable. As accuracy plays a huge role, especially when it comes to small volumes, the right pipetting technique for aspiration and dispensing is important. On this illustration, you can see two major things to remember during aspiration of the liquid with an air cushion pipette. The immersion depth, meaning how deep you put the pipette tip into the liquid, and second, the angle you are using with holding the pipette. Diving in too deep raises the surplus liquid volume in the pipette tip, and you are aspirating too much liquid due to the higher pressure. Additionally, holding the pipette at an angle of 30 to 40 degree raises the surplus volume even more, and you result in an imprecise pipetting. Ideally, holding the pipette upright, vertical, and an immersion depth as shallow as possible leads to the most accurate liquid aspiration as possible. When dispensing the liquid, a 45-degree angle and securing the fill tip on the vessel wall is totally fine. A blowout is absolutely necessary when using manual pipettes. While dispensing, you want to avoid an upright position to not stress yourself too much by additionally spotting the liquid onto the cells. And also do not move your hands over the plate to avoid contamination. Now I have another poll question for you. Do you use a dispenser for small volumes? Yes, no, or I am not sure how to work with these devices. So please answer our question. Do you use a dispenser for small volumes? Yes, no, or I am not sure how to work with these devices. Okay. So I see the results now. So 8% say they never use. No. Sorry, I'm at the wrong question. Now I see it. So 46% answered yes, they use a dispenser also for small volumes, and 53% said no, they don't use a dispenser for small volumes. So now coming back. Using a dispenser makes the whole pipetting process actually much easier, as you do not have to think about immersion depth or aspiration angle or the type of liquid. Additionally, you can also use most liquids with a dispenser, so no matter what the property of the liquid is, like for example viscosity, density, or vapor pressure. And as I said, it also is possible to just do normal pipetting with an electronic device. So with this, now I hand over to Nadine again for the last part of our presentation.
Thanks, Katja. So in this last chapter, I want to give you a few practical tips on some of the most critical steps in your cell-based experiments. So let's have a closer look at this first experimental step that is so important, cell seeding. The precondition for getting comparable results is to seed out the same number of cells for every negative control, positive control, and for every experimental replicate. The more replicates you include, the better for your statistical analysis, of course. Variations in seeding cell numbers and the formation of air bubbles during seeding will not only increase standard deviations, it will also make your results less reliable. Repeating mixing of the cell suspension during seeding and careful pipetting can be a solution. So let's get more into detail on the next slide. When you fill, for instance, a multi-well plate with cells, it will take some time to fill all wells. You can use a single-channel pipette and have the cell suspension in a tube, or you can use a multi-channel pipette and have the cell suspension in some type of reservoir. No matter which of tools you use, the longer the seeding process takes, the higher is the variation in cell number from one well to the other. As you see in this little cartoon here on the right, the cells settle in the tube with time, and the sedimation goes quite fast, within minutes. Therefore, you need to resuspend or mix the cells and to swirl them up in between. Thus, you get an equal number of cells in every well. Saying that, we should keep in mind that cell culture media tend to form due to the high protein content of supplemented serum. Air bubbles can hinder cell attachments, so you should avoid harsh and fast pipetting in order to reduce the formation of air bubbles and also to reduce shear forces, which further stresses the cells. Now let's have a look at how pipetting can affect your assay results. In this graph on the left, you see the results of a cell viability assay. Each column represents one row of a 96-well plate, and the aim was to seed an identical number of cells in each well. The rows were left, two rows were left out for blanks. The cells were seeded with a manual 8-channel pipette from a reservoir. After 24 hours, the number of viable cells was determined using a colorimetric assay. In rows 1 to 5, you see varying cell numbers in the wells and therefore high standard deviations. Here, the user did not mix the cell suspension between pipetting each row, so the cells sedimented in the reservoir with time. In addition, the pipette was held in different angles and heights during aspiration. In rows 6 to 10, you see the results with mixing the remaining cells before pipetting each row, aspirating at constant height in an upright position. Taken together, these results show that the pipetting technique has a big influence on the results. You can also use a dispenser instead of a multi-channel pipette for applying assay reagents or seeding cells, like Katja already introduced to you. With a dispenser, immersion depths and pipetting angle do not influence the precision. With the next slide, I want to talk about another very important step in cell culture, the cryopreservation of cells. When you want to establish frozen cell stocks of high quality, the stress factors need to be minimized. Cryoprotectants like DMSO are harmful to the cells in non-frozen media, and when cells are freshly thawed, they are very sensitive to shear forces. So taken together, time is a very critical factor when freezing and thawing cells. When you freeze the cells, you should be quick from the point where you add the DMSO-containing freezing medium to the cells until you start to cool them down. The cooling procedure itself should then be slow to avoid the formation of ice crystals. To achieve a cooling rate of 1 degree Celsius per minute, use a special freezing container and put the cells into a minus 80 freezer. Should not store the cells for longer time at minus 80, but freeze them in a liquid nitrogen tank or a minus 150 freezer. When you thaw the cells, time is again critical because you want to minimize the exposure to DMSO. So thaw the cells as rapidly as possible and dilute them to decrease the concentration of DMSO in the medium. After that, you can either remove the DMSO directly by centrifugation or dilute the DMSO and change the medium the next day. And again, it is important to mention that freshly thawed cells are sensitive to shear force, so too harsh pipetting should be avoided. In general, it is a good advice to not work with too many samples at a time and to be organized. For example, label cryotubes or culture vessels first before you start to prepare the cells for freezing or thawing. I want to end this chapter with some general remarks about cell banking, because having high-quality cell stocks is your backup system and the prerequisite for reliable research. The most important point is that you make sure that you do not freeze contaminated cells, and that the cell line is really the cell line you think it is, so authentication of cell lines should be performed regularly, especially when you have the cells from another lab and when you use them in a long-term or subsequent studies. The cells you are working with should also be tested for mycoplasma regularly. As Katja mentioned earlier in this presentation, filter tips give extra safety, so they should be considered at least for such important steps like cell banking. The routine use of antibiotics is not recommended because they can mask a contamination with partially resistant bacteria. And please keep in mind that most antibiotics are not effective against mycoplasma anyway. A two-stage cell banking system with a master and working stock provides you constantly with early passages from your cell lines, and a detailed record of the cell stocks is as important as clear labeling of cryotubes. To summarize what we were discussing in this webinar, here we have again the three aspects that are important when talking about pipetting and cell culture: precision, protection, and time. When a precise volume is needed, for example, when pipetting assay reagents, it is important to hold the pipette upright during aspiration and to use a constant immersion step. When you empty the tip, rest it on the vessel wall and blow out the liquid completely. When seeding cells, for example, in a multi-well plate, it is very important to mix the cell suspension in between the pipetting steps to achieve equal numbers of cells and enhance reproducibility of your experiments. But make sure that you avoid the formation of air bubbles. Pipettes are precision instruments, and so to keep the precision, it is essential to calibrate them on a regular basis. The second aspect we were discussing is protection against contamination. You can reduce the risk of contamination when you hold the pipette in a 45 angle so that you do not have your hand directly above the open vessel. For example, when you are feeding or subcultivating the cells, protection is more important than a precise volume. Of course, all pipetting tools used in cell culture should be disinfected before each use. It is also good to autoclave pipettes regularly, but please check with the manufacturer first as the pipettes you are using can be autoclaved. Having a dedicated set of pipetting tools that do not leave the cell culture lab and using filter tips at least for the very important steps like freezing cells help further to protect the cells against contamination. When handling cells and media in the biosafety cabinet, the workspace should be organized. Don't overcrowd the hood with items you do not need. Work only with one cell line at a time and separate clean pipetting tools, tips, vessels, and media from liquid waste, use tips, and so on. Last but not least, time can be a critical factor. For example, the time that it takes for filling all weights of a 96-well plate. Using multi-channel pipettes or a dispenser can save you a lot of time. Dispensers are a good choice for problematic liquids like DMSO or cell culture media. And remember how important it is to avoid the formation of air bubbles when seeding the cells. With a positive displacement system like a dispenser, you avoid air bubbles and you can be very quick in filling multiple wells or dishes. In general, you should not work with too many samples at a time to avoid that the cells are too long at room temperature or reduce the exposure to DMSO when freezing or thawing cells. And with this, I would like to hand over to Christian again before we start the Q&A session.
So thank you both for this great presentation. And before we will start with the last poll question in the Q&A session, I promised you in the beginning to give you a quick insight into a helpful solution that might be helpful for your daily cell culture work. So the first thing I would like to show you different way are our Cell Expert CO2 incubators that we have on the market since a year. Here are a few images that give you a little insight into this. So the Cell Expert incubators come with a fanless design and a seamless chamber that is easy to clean. So it's very easy to disassemble everything and clean it. They also have high temperature disinfection inside. They also give you optimized growth conditions because, which you can see on the right, the atmosphere inside, the homogeneity for temperature is verified at 27 spots inside. And they also have a very high recovery rate, below 5 minutes for temperature and CO2. which is very important if you open the door, so the atmosphere recovers fast. And they also save money for you because they have a smart gas consumption system. They offer you 25% more usable space inside because there is no fan, more space for that. They're made here in Germany, in Hamburg, and for all the devices that are sold until the end of this year, we offer a 5-year additional warranty. If you want to learn more about the Cell Expert and also see it in 360-degree, you can go to eppendorf.com/cellexpert. The next device, which is totally underrated, is our S41i CO2 incubator shaker. So it offers a CO2 incubator with an integrated shaker inside. So it combines the best of both worlds. It's perfect for protein expression in eukaryotic cells, offers flexibility because there's also a shell for static CO2 incubation on the top and also the integrated shaker on the bottom. It's easy to clean. There's a smooth chamber, automatic high-temperature disinfection is integrated, and it also offers you low gas consumption. If you want to learn more about the S41i CO2 incubator shaker, just go to eppendorf.com/S41i. And the next thing Katja already mentioned is our new 25mm conical tubes. I like this image here with the big tube. So, as Katja already mentioned, it improves contamination prevention. And if you want to learn more about the new 25mm tubes, which are available with snap cap or a screw cap, you can go to eppendorf.com/25mm. And last but not least, I already mentioned this as well, is our Inside Cell Culture newsletter. So if you want to get regular information about tips and tricks for your cell culture, free videos, downloads, posters, and more, and also access to advanced educational webinars, and also updates about upcoming webinars, teaching support, upcoming events and trainings, you can simply sign up and get a free download and go to eppendorf.com/insidecellculture or eppendorf.com/ICC. It's really easy to sign up. And with this, I would like to come to the last question. This is the poll question. So we can improve our webinars for you. So the question is, how do you rate the content of today's webinar? We highly appreciate your feedback. So you can rate very good, good, okay, or poor. And thank you very much for your feedback. So now let's go directly to the live Q&A section of this webinar. So if you have any questions that would like to ask Nadine and Katja, please do so now. Just click on the Ask a Question box located on the far left of your screen. We will answer as many questions as we have time for. So let's get started. Our first question is, what is the best method to test for mycoplasma? Who wants to take this question? Oh, I see Nadine is raising her hand.
Yes, it's me. So, thank you for this question. So, there are different methods available to test for mycoplasma. So, for example, fluorescent DNA staining, the biochemical detection ELISA, or even microbiological culture, for example. So when you choose a test method or a test kit, it is important to consider the sensitivity of the assay. So the number of species which are detected, is very important. And all the different methods have advantages and disadvantages. So when you choose a method, it is very important to consider the throughput. So how many samples do you want to test? You should also consider the desired turnaround time. So how long can you wait for the results? So here you have to keep in mind that longer time increases also the risk of spreading the contamination to other culture vessels, as well as lab equipment. So there are different factors which influence your choice of the best test method for mycoplasma. If you are interested to have an overview of all the advantages and disadvantages of the different test methods, for mycoplasma, just have a look at our website, eppendorf.com/cellexperts, and here you can find a download overview with all the advantages and disadvantages of the different methods.
All right, thank you, Nadine. Here comes another classic one. Can I autoclave dispenser tips for reuse? I think, Katja, this one is for you.
Thank you. So, unfortunately, I have to say no. The thing is that the dispenser tips are made out of two different plastic materials, and when heat is applied to these plastic materials, they expand differently, and in the end, that will the tip won't work anymore. So I tested it myself because I didn't believe it when I started here. I tried to autoclave them. They won't work anymore. But you can always buy these tips also in sterile purity grade.
All right. Thank you, Katja. The next one that we have is, how can you see the differences between yeast and bacterial contamination?
I think this is for me. So it's quite easy to distinguish between yeast and bacterial contamination just when you look through the microscope. So when you have a look, you can see that bacteria have a directed movement, which you do not see with yeast. So bacteria can have different shapes, so they can be round, rod, or spiral-like, but are usually smaller than yeast. And yeast appear as separate round or ovoid spherical particles, and they are often in change of two or four or even more particles. Sometimes they are multi-branched. So another hint is the color of the medium. So both contaminants make the medium mostly more acidic. If you use a media with a phenol red as a pH indicator, you can have a look at the color, and if the color changes to a yellow more rapidly because it is because of the contamination with yeast or bacteria.
All right, thank you, Nadine. Here we have another interesting question that was also always a frequently asked question in our lab or during my lab time. The question is it mandatory to use the pipette and the tip from the same manufacturer?
So this strongly depends on the system. So if you are using serological pipettes and a pipette controller, it is not mandatory or necessary to use the same tips or the same pipettes as the controller. But if you are using an air cushion system or a dispenser, as I already said, I highly recommend to do so. And the reason is because the pipettes are adjusted to the tip size. And this tip size or to the according air cushion, let's say. And when the geometry of the tip is changed, the pipette has to be adjusted to that tip size. So if you want to use another manufacturer of tips, then the pipette, you should calibrate or at least adjust the pipette to according to these tips you want to use when they have a different geometry. And additionally, also please keep in mind that the quality of the tips differs from one manufacturer to another. So in some manufacturers also have a very badly shaped tip orifices, which leads to splashes and drops remaining on the tip or in the tip. And also some manufacturers have materials that maybe leach into your sample and your change your experimental results.
Thanks, Katja. Here's a question that is related to disinfection. And the question is, what is better, spray disinfection or wipe disinfection? And the second part of this question is there any danger to cells from spraying flasks with ethanol?
So in general, it is highly recommended to prefer wipe disinfection over spray disinfection to prevent aerosols, and also it enables a complete wetting of the surface for proper disinfection effect. So you should prefer the wiping. When spraying or wiping the filter of a flask with alcohol, there can be indeed a minimal risk of vapor entering the flask and affecting the cells. Yes.
All right. So Thank you, Nadine. The next question is, let's see, which pipette system is more suitable for viscous liquids like glycerol?
Yeah, as I already mentioned in my presentation, so for more viscous liquids, the positive displacement is always the most accurate tool to use, because here the piston is integrated in the tip and wipes the tip from the inside, actually, so that no liquid remains in the tip. Please do not cut the pipette tip. So I did that myself, but that was one of the first things I learned. It's not accurate to cut the pipette. As I already said in the first the question before, the geometry of the tip also has an influence on the accuracy of the pipetting result. So if you cut the tip, the geometry will change, and also this will change the result of your pipetting.
Thanks, Katja. It's also good to hear something from personal experience. So our next question is, which cells, oh, that's an interesting one, which cells are more frequently contaminated with mycoplasma, primary cells or continuous cell lines? Nadine, maybe you?
Yes, it's me. So, primary cells are less frequently contaminated with mycoplasma compared to continuous cell lines. Especially primary cell cultures and early passages are less frequently contaminated, with reported incidences, I think, with up to 5%. Continuous cell lines have much higher incidences of contamination, so I think that was up to 35 or even 40%. So in most cases, the mycoplasma infection do not originate from the donor of the cells, but are introduced during cell propagation. So as we have already discussed during the webinar, so the biggest source of mycoplasma contamination is the scientist himself working with the cells. So therefore, the risk of contamination increases with the number of passages because due to the handling.
Thank you, Nadine. Let's go to the next question that is related to pipetting techniques. And the question is, when should we do reverse pipetting?
Yeah, so with reverse pipetting, it's always a thing. Please don't use reverse pipetting when you pipette aqueous solutions. Reverse pipetting is a special technique you can use when you work with, like, for example, some viscous liquids. Then you would have a more accurate result than just by normal forward pipetting. But with normal aqueous solutions, either if they are larger or smaller, please don't use reverse pipetting. I hear that a lot, that people think reverse pipetting is more accurate than normal forward pipetting, but it's not the case. If you are using reverse pipetting also, or if you want to use reverse pipetting with your normal air cushion pipettes, please also have a look on the scale, whether it's accurate, and if not, please adjust your pipette to this pipetting technique.
All right. Thank you, Katja. Let's see. So many questions. Oh, this one is a good one. How do you avoid the dripping of the 50 ml serological pipette? Katja again, maybe?
Yeah, I think it probably might be a volume or a liquid you are using that has a little higher vapor pressure, and that leads to the dripping of the 50 milliliter serological pipette. If it's some liquid with a higher vapor pressure, maybe. So I recommend you to use a dispenser as well, because the largest tip we have is actually 50 milliliter. So if you use an electronic device like our MultiPad E3 with a 50 milliliter tip, you can pipette 50 milliliters or dispense smaller volumes from the 50 milliliter tip. Yeah.
All right. Thank you, Katja. Let's see, what else do we have? I have to choose a question that can be useful for the majority of people. I think this is one that we covered during the presentation. So the question is, and it's related to freezing cells, and I actually thought like this before. The question is, as far as I was told over the years, freezing cells should be quick to prevent formation of ice crystals. So what is correct, slow or fast freezing?
So I think this one is for me. So maybe there was a mix up. So you should handle the cells as fast as possible. So prepare the cells but carefully as fast as possible with the cryoprotectant reagent containing mostly the DMSO. But the freezing the cells should be should be very stable. So one Celsius degree per minute. So we can discuss if this is fast or not so fast, but this is the overall recommendation. So, yeah.
All right. Thank you, Nadine. So, let's see. I think we have time for maybe one more question. So, there you have to, we have to choose wisely. Okay, so we have a question here. How important are growth factors secreted by cells for overall cell growth?
So this is also a good question. So growth factors secreted by cells during the proliferation is very important. So you provide the cells a lot of growth factors by the medium you are using. Probably you are using serum in the medium or a serum replacement. Maybe you also add additional growth factors separately to the medium. However, during the proliferation of the cells, they start to secrete growth factors on themselves, and this also influences the signaling between the cells and, of course, also the further growth and proliferation. So this is quite important for a good cell growth during the passaging and subcultivation.
So thank you very much, Nadine. Thank you, Katja. Do you have any final comments for our audience?
No, thank you very much for listening. It was a pleasure to talk to you today.
The same for me, and I wish you a nice rest of the day. Bye.
So, before we go, I would like to thank you all for joining us today and for your interesting questions. The questions that we did not have time for today and those that were submitted during the on-demand period will be addressed by the speakers via the contact information you provided at the time of the registration. I would like to thank Nadine and Katja for their time today and also for their brilliant presentation. We'd also like to thank LabRoots or the LabRoots team for supporting us today. This webcast will be available for an unlimited time, and LabRoots will alert you via email when it's available for replay. And we encourage you all to share that email with your colleagues who might have missed this webinar today. I would like also you to know that you will be forwarded at the end of the presentation to our next webinar taking place December 4th. And also keep in mind to have a look at the Inside Cell Culture newsletter site under eppendorf.com/ICC to stay updated for all upcoming cell culture webinars. So we say goodbye from Hamburg. Have a nice day.